Alrighty, so my name is Quentin Dudley. For those of you that do not know me, I'm a fifth year in Mike Jewett's group and do basic research on cell-free metabolic engineering, trying to get metabolic pathways activated in cell extracts. But in the last few weeks, I've gotten really interested in cyanobacteria, and I wanted to share with you kind of what I've learned and use this as an excuse to actually read a lot of literature. So I'm still nervous that everything I know is just from reading. So a lot of you read too. So if you know more than I do, say something, or like, let's have more of a dialogue conversation than just me throwing something together. So my title, I totally stole. Let's see, do I have a laser pointer?
It's the one with the round thing on it.
I'll try yours.
It's not very helpful.
Oh, well. So I totally stole my title from this editorial that came out a few months ago. And but a lot of this outline is kind of my own design and then a really good editorial or review paper from 2015. So this is a model cyanobacteria, and what I want to highlight is a few cool things that cyanobacteria can do. One is they can live on only CO2 and a few nutrients. So that chemistry is all going to be happening in the carboxy zone right here. So inside the carboxy zone is where the Rubisco enzyme that does the first step of carbon dioxide photosynthesis. So that's happening there. Otherwise, you have all of metabolism kind of encased in this cell that exists typically on its own, but can also complex with other neighbors to kind of do some multi-cellular activities, but mostly it kind of acts on its own. So here's kind of an overview of the metabolism that's happening. And so I'm not going to talk much about the carboxy zone in this talk. I wanted to add some slides on it. But again, this is the way in which cyanobacteria concentrates carbon. So in the atmosphere, you know, carbon dioxide's 0.4%, something like that. That diffusion is not enough for cyanobacteria to fix enough carbon to be able to grow and live. However, so what it does is any bicarbonate, so HCO3 here, it actively transports that into the cell. And then when it gets into the carboxy zone, which is a quite large multi-protein shell, it's going to use carbonic anhydrase to convert that carbonate back to CO2, and now you've got a really high local concentration of CO2. Rubisco is going to be a lot more active there. So there's a lot of research that I'm really not going to talk about today of understanding the carboxy zone, what it is, how it works, trying to put it into E. coli and get it to function there. One of the coolest projects I was reading about as well is putting the carboxy zone into C3 plants to kind of improve their ability to fix carbon dioxide. So that's kind of the carboxy zone. It's happening in the Calvin cycle. We have light being harvested by both photosystems up there. Notably, cyanobacteria uses these phycobilanins as their photosynthetic pigments. That's up in the top right there. And you can kind of categorize the phylogeny of cyanobacteria by which ones they use. And so that looks just a little different than chlorophyll down at the bottom left, which you find in a typical plant. So then actually this metabolic map is already dated, even though it's from 2015. The homolog to get a complete TCA cycle was discovered just a few in the last year or so. But all the black markings on there would be examples of how people have used metabolic engineering to try and overproduce, and I say overproduce in a relative sense, chemicals in cyanobacteria to, you know, mitigate all our challenges with climate change and so on and sustainable chemicals. So if you take a look, though, at all of these potential products, we can actually make a lot of them, as this review kind of notes. But if you look at the titer and productivity, they're all pretty meager. If you're in the metabolic engineering literature, kind of a good rule of thumb would be like 1 gram per liter is like success at the academic level, but you're going to need 20 to 100 grams per liter to ever go to commercial scale. So even so, definitely compared to our E. coli and yeast chassis, we have a long way to go. And so what I really want to talk about in the talk today is kind of always coming back to how is cyanobacteria different from E. coli, and how are we going to get it to be more like this green version. So I'm just going to point out a couple labs that I think are cool that are going to keep coming back into the presentation. We're going to talk about some of the most famous strains. There's not one single cyanobacteria strain that gets used all the time, so we're going to try and track that. I'm going to talk about the genetic architecture of cyanobacteria, how that is a problem for us, how we get genes into it. A big theme you can guess is that we need a lot of genetic tools. We'll talk about that. And then ultimately how we're going to deal with the slow growth rate of cyanobacteria and product toxicity. So jumping in, these are my four highlighted cyanobacterial labs. So we have Shota Itsumi. He started at UC Davis and did his postdoc work with James Liao at UCLA. And then Brian Flieger is at University of Wisconsin. Peter Lindblad was kind of one of the first to really start to develop genetic tools, especially like inducible promoters in cyanobacteria. And Himradi Pakrasi has really kind of jumped on that bandwagon and has discovered a really exciting, fast-growing strain that I'll highlight at the end. And so this is not to exclude that there's some really good people like Mellis and Liao and Posowitz who their papers just, I didn't have time to fit them into the presentation, so they're not there. But, so here are probably the four most popular strains of cyanobacteria used in research right now. And so for most of the time, I'll probably start getting into their numbers, like 6803 up top. So it's considered the model organism, probably used the most. It's used the most because it's the easiest to get DNA into. So conjugation, you can add a bacteria to get DNA. Natural transformation would be just you put naked DNA into the test tube. Cyanobacteria will take that up. You can also do some mutagenesis, and there's been preliminary work in assembly of plasmids actually inside 6803. It can also grow on glucose in addition to CO2, so that kind of shortens its doubling time a little bit. But because it's so easy to transform and to get you to all to remember these strains, I have assigned them classic Disney characters. So the most promiscuous Disney character that I could think of was the Tramp. If you've ever listened to that power ballad, you know, he's been around. So 6803 from now on is the Tramp strain. Another popular strain that this doubling time is actually probably listed as a little long. It can vary, but it only grows autotrophically, is 7942, and so it's used in a lot of circadian clock work and modeling of that, trying to put those lessons back into plants. So my analogy for that is, of course, Cogsworth. It's clock, that's all we got there. Another more recent, so there's not as much literature on 7002, but it's nice because it's faster. So we're getting down to a 3.5 hour doubling time. Aladdin, stealing the bread, running around Agrabah, like it's a pretty fast guy. So that's who 7002 is. And then I'm not gonna really feature any work in 7120, but it's famous for being a diazotrope, so it can fix nitrogen. That actually is really beneficial to the organisms around it, so Robin Hood. is who we have featured here.
Are these temperature tolerant? What's their native growth temperature?
So I think it depends on how fast you want it to grow, but we're kind of talking like 30 to 45 is where these grow best. These are all freshwater strains.
Okay.
And so actually that's a nice transition. I was at AIKI last week and I heard a really cool talk on a diazotroph that's actually saltwater tolerant. And so it's called Trichodesmium erythraeum, and it's known as sea sawdust. It's visible to the naked eye. But it's actually, the red pigments in it are what makes the Red Sea red. But this one organism is responsible for 42% of global nitrogen fixation. Like, that's an incredibly huge number. And I thought that was really cool, and that's just a fun fact. We won't come back to that. So these are the strains. They're going to keep popping up. So something I spent a long time thinking about and learning about these past weeks is the genetic architecture of cyanobacteria and why that's really challenging for us. Because, of course, on the left, we have E. coli. And we really like E. coli because it has one genome, circular genome, per cell. And you probably know the trivia fact that genome actually takes 40 minutes to replicate, but we have doubling times of 20 minutes, so you get actually multiple origins of replication at the same time in E. coli, but if you have stationary phase, long, slow growth rates, it's one genome per cell, so it's this monoploid thing. And B. subtilis and C. crescentis are the same thing. And that was kind of my paradigm going into this, is one genome per cell. Cyanobacteria is not that way. So they also have these circular chromosomes, but they have lots of them per cell. So 6803, a paper in 2011, quantified some of this, has 40 to 60 genomes per cell. And that's a really high estimate. All the previous literature was more like the 10 to 12 genomes per cell. But saying we can have hundreds of genomes at the same time during exponential phase, where 7942 and kind of a lot of the other strains I just talked about have more 3-4 genomes per cell. But that's actually going to end up being an advantage for the cyanobacteria, namely that those many copies of the genome you can recover from lots of double-stranded breaks if you're subjected to radiation or more likely desiccation from drying out. You're going to have gene reduction. But what I didn't know is that there's actually, in the prokaryotic landscape, there's more oligoploids than monoploids. So E. coli is it's not the exception, but it's in the minority in terms of that property. So it's an advantage for cyanobacteria, but it's going to be a problem for us.
Yeah, when you say 40 to 60 genomes per cell, does that mean like the entirety of the DNA, or are any of those circular pieces of DNA unique encoding genes that aren't on the others?
So, both. So I think as you get long, stable strains, most of those are going to be pretty homogenous. But as we start introducing, you know, mutation, this is actually a good transition. Let's say here's our hypothetical strain. I took this actually from one of Keith's papers a while ago, and these are supposed to be plasmids, but let's, for the sake of the discussion, imagine that they're genomes. In the top, they're all the same, 3 genomes per cell. You go one down, and you get a mutation in one of them that grows faster. So then as you're continuing to grow and replicate, maybe in step two there, you're going to get an even segregation of those plasmids. So you're going to still be at this medium growth rate. That's what the yellow means. But then if we get segregation that's uneven, you know, maybe we'll get a green cell that actually has two mutations, so it's going to grow even faster. Or we're going to get back to the wild type where it's going to grow slower. So this actually can really become an issue if you're trying to introduce a mutation into cyanobacteria and you put it in and it's a deleterious mutation. So the more your bacteria tries to kick out that genome, the more the faster growing strains are going to be the ones that don't have that change. So what you have to do is restreak over and over and over, and we're talking like it takes a week to get one colony of cyanobacteria to grow visible on a plate to pick. So it takes a lot of work to get all three or four copies of the genome to that one change that you're trying to introduce.
So this sounds like a lot like the problems that gene drives are designed to address. Do you know if anyone's working on gene drives and cyanobacteria to speed up their cloning?
So yeah, CRISPR is in its infancy in cyanobacteria. It's had some trouble, and I'll probably have four or five CRISPR topics that I'll get to by the end. But no gene drive stuff yet. So yeah, so this is kind of this segregation problem that you're going to see. And so pulling from this nicely titled review saying instability is the elephant in the room, how do you know that you have streaked enough to get the colony you think? They've pulled from literature, you know, several papers where, you know, they actually published a negative result saying, oh, we did this, and then it actually went back to the wild type growth rate. So since people don't publish negative results as much as we probably ought to, this might be actually a big problem for us. But there's also examples where they explicitly say, oh, it wasn't a problem when making some of these compounds. So any questions on that topic? Okay. So we do want to make mutation. Here's how we would go about doing it. So the majority of efforts to engineer actually put constructs straight onto the genome. So you would have what would be a suicide vector, so it's able to replicate E. coli, you do all your cloning there, then you introduce it either by natural conjugation with bacteria or natural transformation. It goes in, now you're changing one of your genomes, and then you just do this restreaking and segregation to finally get your homozygous variant there. So the issue with this, and this is kind of the state of the art right now, is every change you want to make, you have to have a selectable marker. So there's three or four common ones, there's maybe seven or eight if you want to get creative, but you can't multiplex and it's a lot of work. If you want your selectable marker back, you can do a second transformation, that would be the middle column there, and you know you can use like SACB as make your strain sucrose sensitive, or there's a streptomycin ribosome mutation where you can leverage that to kick out your selectable marker. It's even more time consuming. I was actually surprised that there's not a lot of plasmid literature in cyanobacteria. They have a lot of native plasmids, and I think that's kind of the problem. And a lot of those native origins don't necessarily replicate E. coli, so they're hard to study. But there's only really one well-characterized plasmid vector that has even copy numbers assigned for it. So I think there's a lot of space for that, but yeah, not much work with plasmids in cyanobacteria. So this option on the left, though, has worked, and we've had some really, a few really successful papers. And I'd say one of the most high profile of these was published in Nature Biotechnology in 2009. And this was Shota Atsumi as the first author in James Liao's lab. And so they were able to make isobutyraldehyde by putting the genes necessary for that on the genome. So you can see they picked one, neutral site one there where they put this KIV-D enzyme to do this step. At another neutral site two, they're going to put three pathway enzymes on there. And that really actually worked well. They did a really nice job in this paper, if you go and read it, of saying algae biofuels grow this fast, this productivity. And by doing this only, we got to two-thirds of that. Really high productivity. And then by actually adding an extra copy of Rubisco to the system at a third site, we got about 50% more productivity than algae biofuels. And I didn't go back and check like if their numbers on their targets were accurate, but yeah, it was really cool. So they were able to make a lot of isobutyraldehyde in carbon concentrated conditions, but still, probably the highest titer you've seen. What was really interesting is then they added the enzyme to go to isobutanol, something a little more useful, and their yields drop by half. So anyway, still a lot of work, but this is probably what would be the most high profile paper. And Shota Itsumi really took that and started his lab and ran with it, and his big success story had been to make 2,3-butanediol. So interestingly, the intermediate right before butanediol is acetoin, which is pretty toxic to E. coli, just like isobutanol probably was, but it's really tolerant to 2,3-butanediol for whatever, up to 30 grams per liter. So they're kind of doing that straightforward, put genes on the genome, that worked, then they got a nice PNAS paper in 2003. Then they kind of did some combinatorial engineering, trying different variants, but this is, you know, the brute force labor. Every one of these mutations is the 3 to 4 week transformation process. Then they also added like a second pathway to pull more carbon flux towards their pathway, bump things up a little bit. So kind of more traditional metabolic engineering. They also did some cool work to feed sugar so that that's what the bacteria or cyanobacteria can eat at night. And then did a little bit of promoter engineering, but I would say the Atsumi lab is famous for their work there. Speaking of inducible promoters, these are something we really need. On the left would be your E. coli promoters that we really love. You know, three orders of magnitude induction, graded for IPTG or ATC. If we try and port those over to cyanobacteria, well, 4-fold induction, 1.6-fold induction, they really don't work nearly as well. And most of these are in 6803 and 7942. There's nothing that's been done in the fast-growing strain, at least when this review was published. And so I do want to highlight that top one up there, 290-fold, and this was a lot of work done by the Lindblad lab at Uppsala. And so they were doing a TET-R system. So TET-R is your repressor, your inducer molecule is an analog of tetracycline. Well, two issues, and also they were using a strain related to 6803, so that's why Bambi showed up. Two big issues with this is huge changes in induction because of the day-night cycle that cyanobacteria experiences. So this is an added complication that we're going to have to deal with. Working with cyanobacteria, is light and dark have totally different metabolism. And your promoters, you probably want them to be nice and constant over that, or match exactly. So a lot of characterization be done there. And they use a lot of ATC. And a big problem, if you've ever worked with ATC, is it's light sensitive. So we're growing these in light. So about 48 hours is how long you get induction to last before degradation of ATC kind of mutate your signal. So problems with that, we want to make better inducible systems. And here's where I want to highlight some work by the Flieger lab. Their strain of choice is 7002. It's fast growing. There's Aladdin, but not as many tools for it. So they started with a cyanobacterial photosystem promoter, so it's a really strong promoter because it's turning on all the proteins we need to harvest light, and they shortened the sequence from like 500 nucleotides to maybe 95 to kind of simplify it. And they lost some strength of the promoter, but importantly, it was no longer light sensitive, so it wasn't really responding to that day-night cycle nearly as much. So they got that, but their fold induction was like 4-fold. And then they did a whole bunch of tuning of different sequences. Kind of that's what we're showing in that part B there. And so you can see in the bar chart as they move from left to right, you're getting larger and larger fold induction. And they end up getting a system with this CELAC-143 that has a 48-fold dynamic range. Not great compared to E. coli, but this is kind of the best that we have for an IPTG inducible system. On the bottom right, then they were like, they actually found some similarities, kind of, to the consensus sequence for the ribosome binding site tuning they did. So they tried to put it into the ribosome binding site calculator, and it didn't really match up. But they're trying, and so there's some challenges with using E. coli stuff. And a big problem with IPTG is cyanobacteria that has no transporter for it. So other non-model organisms, you can put a transporter in, but no one's really done that in E. coli yet. So 48-fold inductions, not that great. But kind of state of the art would be to use metals. There's that, so because cyanobacteria is in these resource-limited environments, as big, 100 to 1,000-fold, as you kind of look at this column here, responses to changing metals in its environment. And so that's probably, if you really wanted something kind of with the old guard set of tools, this is what you use. Issues is it's hard to keep your glassware clean. You basically have to starve the cell of that metal before you induce it. And a lot of times, some promoters respond to multiple metals, or you're going to be turning on and off a lot of other metabolism in the cell if you're going to try and use this. And so this review actually kind of got into a lot of conversation about how sigma factors work in E. coli, or in cyanobacteria. And so there's actually three sets of cyanobacteria sigma factors compared to kind of two categories for E. coli. RNA polymerase in cyanobacteria breaks up the beta subunit into two pieces instead of just the one copy like E. coli. So that all to say, we have all this work in E. coli that we love to port over, and that's not really going to work, mostly because RNA polymerase is structurally different. That's kind of what I had on inducible promoters. So then what are we measuring? Unfortunately, GFP is great in E. coli, but our cells are green. So you're going to have some crosstalk if you want to use the most advanced, cool variants of GFP. You're going to have to do something else. So of course, you can use YFP, cerulean, you can use a mutant of GFP, you know, so these are all pictures of how we're changing the chromophore structure inside GFP. Definitely options there, maybe you don't get the super fast ones. But a challenge is that the dark cycle often has low oxygen concentrations. So that's needed so the nitrogen fixing activity of these cyanobacteria, that's super O2 sensitive. So they're going to try and get all the oxygen out of their system so that nitrogenase can be active then. But you need oxygen to get GFP to fold, and you need oxygens for luciferase to actually do its oxidation. So if you want reliable reporters, you know, they suggest that there's these independent blue light photoreceptors we could engineer, but definitely some work to do there if we're wanting consistent measurements of overall growth conditions. So I already showed you this slide. It takes a lot of work to do this stuff, and this kind of leads into Isaac's point, how CRISPR has to be applicable here somehow, right? We can do that, and really there's not that much. Just this year, this paper came out talking about how you can use CRISPR mostly as a selection mechanism. So they're doing a double-stranded break, but they still need a spectinomycin resistance here. So you're not kind of living up to the potential of CRISPR. They were able to shorten their homology arms a little bit, so that's beneficial. So it's faster than just doing the old way, but really not the end-all be-all. There has been some cool work in CRISPR-I, or what?
Yeah, so with the CRISPRs, anyone try to introduce oxytropy as a cyanobacteria for their cloning?
For their clone, for what?
For cloning methods, yeah, like oxytropic agents. Has anyone tried that?
I know, yes. I know there's like, stuff if you want to, you can knock out pieces of the carboxysome and then it only grows at like high CO2 levels. And I think there's other knockouts you can make, but I don't think they're quite that far along to find that useful compared to they have 5 to 6 antibiotic resistance cassettes that work just as well. So I didn't see much on that. Yeah. So CRISPR-I actually worked quite a bit better. I think dCas9 isn't as annoying to cyanobacteria, is kind of my consensus on this. So they compared some lac-repressed and TEDR-repressed systems, put that machinery on the genome, and this was in the 6803 strain that everybody kind of works with. That worked pretty decent. 100-fold repression of the reporter and showing that you can do it on genome targets. These are random points on the genome that are not random, but genome and targets that they wanted to knock down a little bit. And then again, jumping back to the Flieger lab at Wisconsin, they want their chosen strain 7002 to work good, so they kind of did the same thing. Put all the pieces on the genome under induction and had to do a whole bunch of promoter tuning, a whole bunch of RBS tuning to get, you know, I think, I didn't write it down, but more like this 40-fold repression. So it works. They had some cool applications to show how it works, kind of as I was just referencing with Peter, making things sensitive to carbon dioxide. And they also did try the sRNA platform that worked okay as well. So that's kind of where CRISPR was at, kind of in these general strains. But I want to come back to this big problem of things grow slow. But I want to introduce, just a year and a half ago, a strain came out that grows and doubles in 1.9 hours. So now we're moving to Pixar because we're like Cyanobacteria 2.0. and so UTEX 2973 has got a lot of people really excited. And so that was discovered and characterized by the Procrossi lab at WashU. And so 1.9 hours, about the doubling time of yeast. We can start to work with that. And so they compare it to kind of the other strains up there. It's really closely related to 7942. It has, I think, 55 genomic changes. Some are single nucleotide changes. Some of them are big inversions, but actually not as different as you would think. But it really sucks to get DNA into it. So it's not naturally competent, and you conjugate with it, but it takes a lot more work. And so a big question that they wanted to answer before they published this paper is, why does it grow so fast? And so they posited that glycogen is kind of the answer. So normal cyanobacteria store up lots of carbon and glycogen during the light times, and then they're going to use that when it's dark as their energy source. And so that glycogen you can depict on these dark spots, designated by these white triangles on here, and you don't see those accumulating in the UTEX 2973 strain. So it's basically like going for broke, not storing any carbon. I hope it survives or can catabolize other pieces of itself when it gets dark. So, cool, we got this fast-growing strain, and you know, the Crossy lab kind of has the bead and the lead on working with it, so they jumped in to try CRISPR with it. And so this is kind of the first example of CRISPR actually working. They tried putting it on a cyanobacterial plasmid and couldn't get anything to work. And Cas9 was just on too much and probably has a lot of off-target effects. So then they put it on a streptomyces-based system, which wasn't supposed to replicate, actually. It's had a higher growth temperature than what that red origin was supposed to handle. But it kind of worked. And so they could get that plasmid to perpetuate for 10 generations, and then it left really easily. And yeah, so they're all doing this on a single plasmid that has the Cas9, it has your homology arm, and it has the guide RNA all on one thing. And so, yeah, this is like 4 months old. So, first example of scarless Cas9 genome engineering. Was there a question before?
Yeah, just to double check. Is that autotrophic doubling time? Like it doubles in less than 2 hours, just growing on light and CO2?
Yep. So you can see up at the top here, they're putting all their different conditions. So that's doubling time with enhanced CO2. We're 3% not atmospheric, and a little elevated growth temperature at 41, and pretty strong light intensity. But yeah, that is autotrophy only. I think so. I know 7942 is an autotroph. It can't grow on glucose. So I'm assuming, I don't remember in the paper if they said specifically if it can or not, but I think the characterization was, yeah. Okay. So I have two more topics, one slide each, and then we'll wrap up here. First is product toxicity. These organisms are great, we want to use them. If we actually got to the titers we wanted, though, could they survive? And so this work in 2014 did a really nice job of comparing the kind of the three standard strains. So, you know, 79, you know, these all have the Disney characters you've seen already. And you can see, like, for ethanol, actually the fast-growing 7002 does better than the other ones, but we're not nearly as good as E. coli engineered to handle this does. Same thing for isobutanol. 702 does well, but not nearly as well as E. coli, best in the literature. Fatty acids, also really poor, but we have a different strain that's more robust to fatty acids. So same thing for alkanes down at the bottom. Not nearly as tolerant, but here's where, So picking the right strain for your product could be as important as anything. And so this Ann Ruffing published a paper showing exactly that. They ported a pathway from one strain to another and showed they got higher titers just because toxicity wasn't as bad. But not very well understood mechanisms and a lot of work to go here before we can actually get commercial strains. And then I didn't talk really about any of like the genome modeling and the challenges with that because I'm not as comfortable reading that literature. There's a lot of issues with annotating cyanobacterial literature or genes and so on. But one computational paper that I did like talked about what is the fastest we can grow. And he actually talked about this growth rate being in these regions down here being limited by some nutrient. Okay. But as we get higher and higher and higher, he was talking about the physics of you need to pack a lot more metabolism into a cell because you have fixed carbon, because you have more genome than E. coli. So if you're going to fit all that into a cell, but you still have to have it small enough to have nutrient exchange across there, you're going to reach some point where things in that cell are just so packed together, you just don't have diffusion working as well as it should. And so they did a computational model to kind of figure out what that mu max might be. This was published before the UTEX dash from Incredible Strain came out, so I'm not sure how that fits in, but kind of an interesting way to see where the field might be at. So, in summary, we can make lots of products, just not very much of them. We need genetic tools. CRISPR will get there, but it's really lagged, even compared to mammalian cells and other stuff. So, faster growing strains, this issue of genetic stability and toxicity of products. So, that's what I have, and I'll happily take any questions.
So,
I think algae is kind of where it's at right now.
Okay.
Lots higher titers. They're more robust to grow outside in the ponds. So I could name off five or so algae stuff, but not that I know of off the top of my head.
Do algae, do you know if algae grow faster just on like a mass basis per unit time?
So I think the big thing with algae is you can get like 70 to 80% of their biomass to go to lipids. And you gotta then extract them, and that's really costly and expensive, and that's why the economics don't quite work, but you just got a lot more product there. I did see a nice talk at AGI by Matthew Posowitz at Colorado School of Mines, and he was really talking about using cyanobacteria and getting picking targets that separate out really easily, so you kind of have your bioreactor sitting happy in your media, and so he's done some isoprenoids is what he's really excited about. So there's a good case study of isoprene being made, limonene. So I think that's a future direction because that might be a way as you kick out those molecules where you don't have the processing steps that you might have for algae.
Yeah,
so I've always thought that like the goal with cyanobacteria is to have something where you basically just like pump in filtered seawater and shine light on it, and it makes your product magically. And so I guess it seems like that goal would be better suited with sort of seawater, seagoing strains. And so you mentioned that there was like one seagoing strain that people have talked about recently, but is the field generally sort of, do they think these are the strains to go with for optimization, or is there still a lot of like searching around for what's the right strain?
I also saw a talk on this at AP by a Chinese group that's really excited about a halo tolerant because they can survive salt water. There's just not as much work that's been done. So I think we're kind of at the analogous to E. coli. There's streptomyces strains that can make natural products better. There's custom strains out there. Just all the work's been done in E. coli. All the work has been done in these freshwater strains, especially 6803, and like that's what we know. So that's what we keep using. So I haven't seen a consensus on a halo tolerant strain.
How well is the metabolome characterized? I mean, is this something that you can very predictably go in and do metabolic engineering, or is there a lot of work to do there too?
Lots of work. I didn't even want to start on FBA literature here, because it's a bigger metabolism too, and most FBA models don't have CO2 fixation built in very well, and tons of work. We don't really know.
And how much does it complicate things to have? I mean, how much do you rewire the metabolism? Is it completely different?
Exactly. One paper I really liked talked about transcriptomic, and they did a big transcriptome study, and they show that, so cyanobacteria is in the light, it goes to dark, and then actually, like, it has an internal clock knowing that a couple hours before it's going to be light again, it starts changing all its metabolism, getting ready. So as soon as the light comes on, boom, it's ready to go and make as much glycogen as it can handle. So when does that start versus when does actual light metabolism start? You have many phases of metabolism to deal with.
I came in a little late, so I don't know if we need to talk about this, but I know in cyanobacteria, I think the like circadian system is like pretty well understood and like pretty simple. The translator, people have like tried to like make adjustments to that and try to see like if that has a big impact on like titers you get and like.
I think so. So that would all be that 4794 strain. I think they've definitely got the global regulators figured out, but they're not sure how those global regulators affect the subset of regulators, affect metabolism of your target gene. I think they know the big stuff, high level, still a lot of work to how that trickles down.
All right, guys, time has flown. There's a class outside, so let's thank Quentin one more time.